Let's make some classic BMC dollar store dungeon terrain, something that will work really well for D&D and RPGs, but also be a cool backdrop for like your Fire Slayer army. This week's sponsor is The Printing Goes Ever On. It's a online customizer where you can design and print your own minis, and one of the themes they have on there is all this like dwarven stuff, and I made this really cool dwarven warrior riding his war goat. It's really cool, and I just knew I had to build something dwarven themed, so that's what I did.
I headed to Dollarama to grab these dwarf action figures that I've seen there for months and knew that at some point I'd eventually do something with them. But when I walked in, I got kind of worried because I couldn't find them. But I managed to find two dusty old packs at the very bottom corner of the toy aisle. So it looks like these things are on their way out. So if you want them, grab them while you can. I had no idea what I was going to make with these guys at this point. I was thinking about making some kind of dwarven city entrance, maybe having them hold up like a large stone lintel, or possibly they could be supports of some kind of bridge or walkway. But they had these holes in their hands to hold accessories that these cheap toys actually didn't come with, I should mention. So I thought it might be easier to make use of that feature instead of trying to hide it. They were basically the perfect size to hold some wood dowels that I had, but I still didn't know what the heck to have them doing holding these dowels. I played around for quite a while trying to come up with a position that made some sort of sense. I really like the idea of them standing across from each other and holding these dowels for something. Not sure what, but face to face with their arms down ended up being the position that things sat the most naturally, given their kind of slightly different arm lengths and positions. I still didn't know what this thing would be, but I felt confident enough in being able to do something with this kind of setup here that I epoxied the dowels in place. But now what? I looked through a box of random bits and I grabbed a couple of these bottle lids that I know each and every one of you terrain crafters also saves and keeps on hand. Now, a lot of them, the typical ones, have a sort of gothic arch on them, but I had two that had more of like a square design that seemed way more dwarven, so I grabbed those. The tops of the lids had logos for the juice or whatever, and that I obviously didn't want to be visible, so I cut some circles out of plastic card, glued that on top to cover the designs, and then I just glued the dwarves on top of these. Whatever the hell these were gonna be. I looked over and I saw a blister pack sitting on my desk from some minis, and I had that light bulb moment. These could be massive mechanical statues in a dwarven foundry pouring out molten metal. And this is where I got excited. Finally, knowing what I was actually building, I grabbed some half-inch XPS foam and cut out a quick base. I made a cutout to embed the lower blister pack to kind of like act like a sunken metal vat area thing. And the blister pack was unfortunately deeper than the foam was thick, so I had to figure out a way to reconcile those two thicknesses. And I opted to keep the bottom flush and then just cut some strips of foam to create a ledge for the lip of the plastic to sit on. Now, the foam itself was a bit too plain by the standards of dwarven stonesmith, so I used a simple technique of edge rabbiting the foam to give it a kind of stepped look. This is pretty simple to do with an X-Acto knife. You just need to make two cuts that intersect on the edges and remove this square strip of material. And because this is in what will be stone, these cuts don't need to be perfectly even or straight, and there's a whole fair bit of forgiveness to them. But the base still needed some extra dwarven embellishments, so I thought, maybe just carve in some runes. I just used a simple knife and pencil technique. But for the actual runes, I drew them out first with a Sharpie marker to make sure that I could like kind of plan out the spacing and that worked okay. You know, the hardest thing about putting on runes to a build like this is finding something suitable to write that also fills the space appropriately and evenly like you want, and then not incorrectly spelling something because you accidentally, you know, drew the wrong rune or for a letter or two, which I absolutely did not do, I promise, just don't try to translate what I wrote. With sufficient added flair, I could then texture the foam a bit to look more like stone and glue the dwarf boys in place. These plastic blisters were really thin and flimsy, so I needed to do something to stiffen up the bottom of the one that would just be resting on those two little dowels. And I thought it would be perfectly fitting and somewhat poetic to use the cardstock backer from the toys themselves to do this. To create a backing for the molten pour, I also used some of the clear packaging from the toys to cut a little strip of plastic that I just glued in place. This is where I made one small mistake, and I didn't notice that I was kind of gluing it on at a bit of an angle instead of exactly plumb down at 90 degrees, which it should be for, you know, heavy molten metal pouring out of something. Then I grabbed some Vallejo texture paste and put it on all of the exposed plastic and card to give it a bit of a rough texture. I did the same on the plastic card bases, and I also used the paste to kind of like haphazardly fill all the big gaping joints on these cheap toys. And for the molten metal, I just used simple acrylic latex caulking watered down with a bit of water. I thought I was being smart for a moment by adding some yellow ink right into this mix because this would, you know, make it easier to paint up later. But I quickly realized that this was pointless since I, you know, would be spray painting everything right away and it would end up getting covered unless I was being super careful, which I wouldn't be. And it's also important to note this yellow ink that I pulled out here and used because it's going to be comically relevant later. I tried to make this layer of caulking fairly thin so that it would actually dry overnight all the way through rather than just creating this hard skin on top that would be filled with, you know, wet caulking for weeks or months. Oh, and I dropped in some plastic decorative round gems to create a few bubbles. While that dries by the heater overnight, let's take a second to talk about this week's awesome sponsor. The Printing Goes Ever On is an online customization tool for designing and exporting custom miniatures that you can print yourself at home. It has a bunch of different options to create custom characters for RPGs or a horde of unique models for your warband. Once you have your design finished, you can export the model as either one piece or separate bits, and it's all pre-supported. This service works a bit differently than other similar ones. You don't pay for every single model you download. Instead, you pay a one-time fee to unlock themed bundles like dwarves or elves full of cool options. And then you can export as many different models using these kits and pieces as you want. So if say you want to buy like the dwarf bundle and create and export 150 unique dwarf characters, well, you can do that for the same price of one or two model exports from their competitors. Now you can buy these bundles individually from their website or join their Patreon to get it and other models at a huge discount. Another cool feature of these models is that they export at the classic true 25mm scale, which fits in perfectly with those old school minis in your collection. But you know, if you want them to fit in with more modern heroic models, you can simply scale them up to 115% to get them to 32mm scale. I'll put a link to them in the video description and you can just go play around with the customizer to see how it works. And I'll also include a link to a free STL model so you can download it and print it out yourself to test the quality of the sculpts and the supports. All right, with the yellowy mustard goop dry, I could move on to priming and painting. For this, I just used cheap rattle can flat primer as it bonds to all the various materials in this build and dries very quickly. I used some more of the same primer, but in a gray to do a bit of a highlight undercoat to get things closer to their final intended color before breaking out the airbrush paints and inks. Now, I first used white ink to build up the white base layer for the molten metal, as well as to highlight the figures. And then I could move on to the metallics, and I love using these Vallejo Air Metallics. They work so well through an airbrush and cover wonderfully, and they have a really authentic metallic look to them. I first did a coat of gunmetal on all the statues and everything, and once they were completely covered, I went back in with a gold and just kind of roughly picked out details like their hair, armor, and jewelry. Projects like this where some overspray doesn't matter much is a great way to kind of just like freely practice some freehand detail airbrush work. It's not something I'm great at, but it's something I get a little better at each time I do it. So I'm always glad to have the opportunity to practice. I thought it actually might be cool to tint some of the gold metallics with a bit of raw sienna ink to make it look more red. And I could use this to give kind of like a third different tone to things like their hair and their beards, which would not only give the piece a little bit more depth, but it would also give it that cool Fire Slayer look. I used a tan to go over all the stone just really quickly with a splotchy coating, and this would hide all of the metallic overspray. Then I added a bit of white ink to that same paint just to lighten it up a bit and do some very splotchy, simple highlights. But now it's time to try and paint the molten metal. This would start with airbrushing yellow ink. So I grabbed the yellow ink that was on my shelf beside me, and I immediately noticed that it was really fluorescent and had a fair bit of a green tint to it. And I thought to myself, man, I should just buy like some normal canary yellow ink to have on hand. Completely forgetting that I already did, and it was just sitting a few feet away from me on the desk from when I used it to tint that caulking on the previous day. Oh well, totally forgetting that I had that ink, I just dealt with the fluorescent yellow by mixing in a tiny bit of orange to get it to a more appropriate tone. And from here, it was just a matter of using layers of orange and red until I built up the right colors. And I didn't nail this. In the end, it did look a lot more like melted, hot, burning cheese than I would have liked. But, you know, it was all right. But it definitely could have used another, you know, highlight of the proper yellow right in the middle at the end to give it that real glowing hot look. Now, after that, it was just time to get the base ready for the final washes with a simple dry brushing of light gray craft paint. Oh, and I also highlighted some of the bubbles with a little bit of white and yellow. And then it was finally time to finish this piece off with some oil washes. And I was really excited to do this. I've been dipping my toes into oils for the last couple weeks, and this would be the first large terrain piece that I'd tried them on. And I was really looking forward to it. I felt like it would just perform and look so much better on these metallic statues than, you know, just a typical homemade wash. For this wash, I just made one that was a mixture of black, burnt umber, and burnt sienna. I wanted something that was dark with some rich reddish brown undertones, as I thought this would work nicely on both the metallics and the stone base. And it would give this piece a bit of needed warmth that would be really appropriate next to all that molten steel. You know, this piece is pretty crafty. It's like definitely not a display piece. It uses toys from the dollar store. It uses garbage packaging. But in terms of fun, cheap terrain that was quick to build, I think it's fantastic. I'd happily use this in a session of D&D or even throw it on an appropriate table for a quick battle. These kinds of builds are all about being creative and thrifty and making something out of nothing, and just having fun doing it along the way. I think that a lot of you could take this idea and make it your own and even make it much better. Personally, I really love the idea of these two massive mechanical dwarven statues operating this big foundry deep inside of some gnarly mountain.
I hope you guys enjoyed this video. If you did, hit the like button, let me know in the comments section below. And if you want to grab some hobby supplies for yourself and support the channel in the process, be sure to do your hobby shopping through blackmagiccraft.ca. There I have a resource essential equipment page with links to all the stuff that I use regularly. Also, if you really enjoy these videos and you really want to help me keep making them, the best way you can do that is by supporting the channel on Patreon. Those funds go a long way to making all of this possible. I appreciate each and every one of you, and if you are not a member, I'd love to have you as the newest member of the Black Magic Craft Fellowship. That's it for this week, guys. Cheers. See you next week.